all of you. Today's lecture, we are going to discuss the protection of wildlife in India. In the last few lectures, we have seen that with regard to the protection of a forest in India, we saw the statutory framework or the legislative framework, we saw the constitutional framework, and also the role of judiciary in protecting the forest. So today we are going to discuss the protection of wildlife in India. Again, this will be looked from the perspective of statutes, then from the constitutional perspective, as well as the role of judiciary in protecting the wildlife in India. Let us see the definition which is given by Webster's dictionary with regard to the term wildlife. It says that living things that are neither human nor domesticated. So all living things are included under the definition of the term wildlife, except human beings, as well as what all animals we human beings domesticate. Rest, everything is included, especially mammals, birds and fish, which are hunted by man. So that's a crude form of definition you can see, which is given by the Webster's dictionary. And the report of the Indian Board of Wildlife, they gave a report in the year 1970, which is titled as Wildlife Conservation in India. It defines the term wildlife as entire uncultivated flora and fauna of the country. So the what do you mean by flora and fauna? Flora and fauna means plants and animals. So entire uncultivated flora and fauna, that means whatever is not domesticated or cultivated by human beings, rest, everything is considered as wildlife. And what are the importance or significance of wildlife? There are various importance which is attached to the wildlife also. One is aesthetic importance. It gives a happiness, it gives a sense of, we appreciate the beauty. Say for example, if we are seeing a butterfly, if you are seeing a peacock, we appreciate its beauty, right? So that is the aesthetic significance we are talking about. Then the recreational significance. Most of the animals and species are being captured and their specimens are kept in the zoos. So it gives, and we go to zoos and all for recreational purposes. So it gives a recreational, it has a recreational significance also. Then economic benefits. Most of the wild animals, their body parts, etc. are used for economic benefits also. One good example I can give you is like the honey, which is made by the honeybees, that gives economic value, that has an economic value. So there are economic benefits also. Then ecological significance. See, in the ecosystem, take any plant or animal, it has its own role to play, the maintain the balance in that ecosystem. So that is being done by the wildlife in their own role. So ecological significance is also important. Now, what is this wildlife depletion? So there is no doubt that why we are thinking about legal regulation to protect the wildlife, there is obviously wildlife depletion. The number of or the amount of wildlife reserve we have has been depleted over the years. So that is why we are thinking of ways to prevent that depletion and protect and enhance and improve the wildlife. So what are the causes of wildlife depletion? One major cause is industrialization. You can link this with the previous lectures in which we discussed the causes of pollution also. So the depletion of wildlife is directly linked to industrialization, urbanization, increasing human population. When human beings doesn't have space to live, they started encroaching upon the forest areas where these animals were living. So increasing human population reduced the space which was there for the animals. Then the pollution of the environment, definitely that is one major reason you can point out. Then hunting either for food or even for recreational purposes also. So hunting is another major cause for wildlife depletion. Then clearing of forest, obviously that is related to the increase in human population. Increase in human population generally results in clearing of forest, that because human beings need space to live, need space to start agriculture, for all these aspects, they clear the forest, which reduces the space which were actually meant for the wildlife. Then draining of swamps, then damming of rivers. So all these has actually tilted the balance of the ecosystem, and which has resulted in the wildlife depletion. So let's see what is wildlife conservation and why wildlife conservation is important. Wildlife conservation includes all human efforts to preserve wild animals from extinction. So due to the human activity, there is no doubt that there is depletion of wildlife, and now we are trying to conserve it. And conservation means whatever efforts we take or put in order to preserve wild animals from extinction. I'm sure all of you might have heard the terms extinction, endangered species, etc. That means there is a rampant depletion of wildlife, which we are trying to prevent, or we are trying to stop in the ways which human beings can. And it is a protection and wise management of wild species and their environment. So, this is what is known as wildlife conservation. It means the protection and wise management of wild species and their environment. So, wild animals can sustain only in their environment or in their habitat. If you are destroying the habitat of the wild animals, their survival will be at peril. And in India, it was estimated that over 500 mammalian and 1,200 bird species were there in existence. But it was interrupted by the unprecedented intervention with the nature. Because when industrialization took place, when we moved on to urban cities, so a lot of changes happened during this time. And wildlife conservation is important for various reasons. One is survival value, that every species plays an important role in maintaining an ecological balance. I've already mentioned this. And loss of any species, it threatens the survival of several species, including man. So, say for example, if all the frogs in a locality or an ecosystem is destroyed, then what would be the situation? The number of mosquitoes will be increasing. The same is with regard to lizards also. So each and every living being in that particular ecosystem has its own significance. Then there are a lot of scientific values also attached to that. Say for example, knowledge about the life processes, etc. Like there are a lot of scientific experiments being conducted on the animal species. Then economic value, we have already discussed that. We depend upon the wildlife for food. We depend upon the wildlife for fur. Most animals, their skin is being used, like wool, fur, etc. Then it has also aesthetic or beauty value. That is, we use wildlife for recreation purposes, then we use it for tourism purposes, etc. So that is why we are trying to conserve the wildlife in whichever way it is possible for the human beings. So let us look into the history of wildlife protection in India. India is one of the few countries which had a forest policy since 1887. And the first few legislations are mentioned herein. One is Wild Birds Protection Act of 1887. It actually prohibited the possession or sale of certain kinds of wild birds during the breeding season. Then another statute came up in the year 1912, that is Wild Birds and Animals Protection Act of 1912. It was later amended in the year 1935 also. And this statute allowed the provincial government to declare any area to be a sanctuary for the birds or animals, and their killing was made unlawful. But these provisions were not stringent and were inadequate. And in the last session, we saw the Indian Forest Act of 1927, and that statute also incorporated certain provisions restricting hunting in the reserved and protected forests. So these are the historical framework where we can see the legislations protecting or intended to preserve and conserve the wildlife in India. The constitutional provisions has been discussed over and over again. There was no provision in the constitution as it was enacted in order to protect the wildlife as it is. But with this 42nd Amendment Act to the amendment to the constitution, which was in 1976, it incorporated certain provisions into the constitution specifically to deal with the protection of wildlife. First aspect is that forest and wildlife, it was there in the list 2 or state list under the Schedule 7, but it was moved to the concurrent list. That means the implication is that earlier only the state government, state legislature could enact a legislation on for the protection of wildlife. But right now, since the subject has been included under the concurrent list or list 3, the central union parliament as well as the state legislature can enact legislations for the protection of wildlife. And Article 48A, the directive principle, principles of state policy, it directs that the state shall endeavor to protect and improve the environment and to safeguard the forest and wildlife of the country. So the state is duty bound to make legislations for the protection of wildlife under 48A. And the amendment also introduced the fundamental duty, and Article 51G imposes a duty on the citizens to protect and improve the natural environment, including forests, lakes and wildlife. So this is a constitutional mandate which has been incorporated into the constitution with the 1976 amendment, where you can see there are provisions, specific provisions for the protection of wildlife in India. Now let us deal with the specific statute for the protection of wildlife in India. It is the Wildlife Protection Act of 1972, and this statute was passed under Article 252 of the Constitution on request from various states. And protection of wildlife during those days was a state subject under List 2 that we saw in the previous slide. And it was before the constitutional amendment of 1976. So the parliament enacted Wildlife Protection Act under 1972, and by a 1991 amendment, the parliament extended the act to the whole of India except Jammu and Kashmir. That means in the year 1976, the subject wildlife was taken from list 2 and put under the list 3. So the parliament is empowered to make legislation for the protection of wildlife after 1976. And in 1991, parliament extended this particular act, which was enacted in the year 1972 under Article 252, to the whole of India except Jammu and Kashmir. And what are the objectives of this particular legislation? There are twofold objectives. One is effectively protecting the wildlife, and secondly, to control poaching, smuggling and illegal trade in wildlife and its derivatives. So it is intended to fulfill two main objectives. One is effectively protecting the wildlife, and also to control poaching, smuggling and illegal trade in wildlife and its derivatives. On a closer analysis, we can see that the statute provides legal framework for the following aspects. One is prohibition of hunting. You can see the provisions in detail, but generally it prohibits hunting. Secondly, protection and management of wildlife habitat. Thirdly, establishment of protected areas. There are several categories of protected areas mentioned under this statute, and they are national parks, wildlife sanctuaries, tiger reserves, conservation reserves, community reserves and biosphere reserves. We'll discuss in detail in the coming sessions, but for now you just understand this much. It aims at establishment of protected areas for the protection of wildlife. The next is it regulates and controls trade in parts and products derived from the wildlife. Say for example, rhino horn of the rhinoceros. So these are parts and products derived from wildlife. So that is the trade is regulated and controlled in such parts and products derived from wildlife. Then management of zoos, that is yet another aspect. So these are the different aspects which are covered under this particular statute intended to protect the wildlife in India. So moving on with the provisions of the statute, firstly we'll see certain important definitions. Here in the statute, definition clause is very, very important, because these words are being kept on repeating again and again, and without knowing the meaning of these words, it is very difficult to understand the entire scheme of the act, first thing. Secondly, you'll have to understand the names of the animals. Wildlife is being included under the schedules which is attached to this particular statute. You can see five schedules attached to the statute which lists out the names of the animals. So these are the two things you need to understand the beginning itself. We'll come to the details later. So let's start with the important definitions. So first definition which I would like to introduce to you is section 2 clause 37, 2 clause 37, which defines the term wildlife. And the definition goes on like this: wildlife includes any animal, bees, butterflies, crustacean, fish and moths, and aquatic or land vegetation which forms part of any habitat. So as the definition suggests, it is an inclusive definition, and it includes all the animals, bees, butterflies, then crustacean, fish includes these crabs, shrimps, lobsters, etc. Then it includes moths, aquatic or land vegetation, which forms part of any habitat. So this is how the term wildlife has been defined under section 2 clause 37 of the statute. It is the definition has a wide connotation, and also it is an inclusive definition. Now moving on to the next definition, the next important definition is 2 clause 1, which defines the term animal. And the term animal includes, again it is also an inclusive definition. Animal includes amphibians, birds, mammals and reptiles and their young, and in the case of birds and reptiles, their eggs also. So that, again, the definition of the term animal is also so wide. It includes all the amphibians, birds, mammals, reptiles, their young ones, as well as their eggs are also considered to be the definition of animals, included in the definition of animals. Now, next important definition is mentioned under 2 clause 2, that is animal article. What do you mean by animal article? It means any article made from any captive animal or wild animal other than vermin. I'll explain to you what do you mean by vermin. So vermin is an exclusion, just understand this much now. And includes an article or object in which the whole or any part of such animal has been used, and ivory imported into India, and an article made therefrom. So again, this is also a very complicated definition. It says that an animal article means any article which is made from any captive animal or any wild animal other than vermin. So vermins are excluded from the definition of animal article. Anything which is made from vermins are not included under the definition of animal article. And it also includes an article or an object in which the whole or any part of such animal has been used, as well as ivory which is imported to India and an article made therefrom. So again, animal article has been defined in such a way to include anything which is made from a captive animal or a wild animal other than vermin, and it also includes the ivory which is made which is imported to India and any article which is made therefrom. Now let's see what do you mean by vermin. Vermin is defined under section 2 clause 34 of the act, and it means any wild animal specified in schedule 5. I told you wild animals are listed out in various schedules, and schedule 5 speaks about vermins. Whatever animals which are mentioned under schedule 5, we call them as vermin. And when you just go to the schedule 5 and see what all animals are included in schedule 5, and you can see common crow, fruit bats, mice, and rats. So these categories of animals, which are mentioned under Schedule 5, we call them as vermin. And understand this definition of the term vermin and what all are included under vermin, because we'll be keeping on repeating the term vermin again and again. Now let's see what you mean by captive animal. I had used the term captive animal under Section 2, Clause 2. So what do you mean by this captive animal? Captive animal means any animal specified in Schedule 1, 2, 3 or 4, which is captured or kept or bred in captivity. So any wild animal which is mentioned under Schedules 1, 2, 3 and 4, that is, vermins are not included here also, and which is captured or kept or bred in captivity. So they are kept in captivity, or their breeding is being conducted in captivity. They are kept as captive animals. And that definition is given under Section 2, Clause 5 of the statute. The next important definition is 2 Clause 16, which defines the term hunting. In various occasions, you can see that the term hunting has been used, and it's not just the common meaning which we know with regard to hunting. Section 2 Clause 16 defines hunting. With its grammatical variations and cognate expressions, hunting includes, again, it is an inclusive definition, it is not an exhaustive definition. Hunting includes A, capturing, killing, poisoning, snaring, and trapping of any wild animal, and every attempt to do so. So hunting is given such a wide definition. The first clause, it says that it can be capturing, killing, poisoning, snaring, and trapping of any wild animal, or even an attempt to do so, is also covered under the definition of the term hunting. And clause B, driving any wild animal for any of the purposes specified in the subclause. Not even attempting is also included, or even driving any wild animal in order to capture, or in order to hunt or kill or poison. So that also is included. Then injuring or destroying or taking any part of any such animal, or in the case of wild birds or reptiles, damaging the eggs of such birds or reptiles, or disturbing the eggs or nests of such birds or reptiles. So with regard to any animal, either injuring them or destroying or taking any part of such animal, that also amounts to hunting. And in cases of wild birds and reptiles, either damaging their eggs or disturbing their eggs or nest, that also amounts to hunting. So the definition of hunting is again very, very wide, and it includes all these things, even killing them, it is included, poisoning, snaring, trapping, then attempt to do all these things, then driving any wild animal for these purposes, then injuring any wild animal or destroying any wild animal or take any part from them, or if in the case of wild birds and reptiles, disturbing their eggs or nest. So all these activities are included under the definition of the term hunting. Now let's see Section 2, Clause 18A, livestock. Livestock includes, again, inclusive definition, buffaloes, bulls, bullocks, camels, cows, donkeys, goats, horses, mules, pigs, sheep, yak, and also includes their young. So livestock is generally, which is these animals are generally domesticated and grown by the human beings. So it includes buffaloes, bulls, bullocks, camels, cows, donkeys, goats, horses, mules, pigs, sheep, yak, and also includes their young. Now Section 2, Clause 30, it defines the term taxidermy. Taxidermy is a technical term. It says, with its grammatical variations and cognate expressions, it means the curing, preparation, or preservation of trophies. So taxidermy generally means curing, preparation, or preservation of trophies. So in order to understand what is taxidermy, you need to know the definition of trophy also. That is mentioned under 2 clause 31 of the statute. It says that trophy means the whole or any part of any captive animal or wild animal other than vermin, which has been kept or preserved by any means, whether artificial or natural, and includes rugs, skins, and specimen of such animals mounted in whole or in any part through the process of taxidermy. So taxidermy is essentially a process in which you preserve the animals, like stuffing the animal and all. So that is known as trophy. Okay. And it also includes antler, horn, rhinoceros horn, feather, nail, tooth, musk, eggs, and nest. So trophy also includes these stuffed animals along with their horns, their feathers, nails, tooth, musk, eggs, nest. All these are considered to be trophy. So come back once again to the definition of the term trophy. Taxidermy. Taxidermy means the curing, preparation, and preservation of trophies. So the process of preserving the animals as stuffed animals and all, that process is known as taxidermy. And trophy means when an animal has been preserved by any means. It can be either artificial means or natural means, and it also includes all the parts of the animals, like it can be the horn of the rhinoceros, feather, nail. All these are included under trophy. I hope that is clear to you. Next important vermin we have already covered. Next important definition is wild animal. Wild animal means any animal found wild in the nature and includes any animal specified in Schedule 1, 2, 3 or 3, 4 or 5 wherever it is found. So any animal which is listed in any of the schedules from 1 to 5 we call as wild animals. Even if it is there in the forest, we are finding them in the forest, or they are captive animals, wherever you find it, they are considered to be wild animals. Now, what do you mean by zoo? Zoo is also defined under Section 3, Clause 39, 2, Clause 39. It says an establishment, whether stationary or mobile, where captive animals are kept for exhibition to the public, but does not include a circus and an establishment of a licensed dealer in captive animals. So zoo is generally very easy. It is an establishment. It can be either stationary or it can be a mobile establishment also, where these captive animals are kept for exhibition. But two things are excluded. One is animals kept for circus is excluded, and also animals kept by a dealer in captive animals. These two are exceptions. Rest, whatever establishment is put up for the exhibition of these wild animals, we call it as a zoo. Moving on to the chapter 2, it speaks about the authorities established under the Wildlife Protection Act. So you can see a number of authorities are being constituted under the statute, and section 3 says that central governments may appoint Director of Wildlife Preservation, Assistant Director of Wildlife Preservation, and such other officers and employees as may be necessary. So it is a discretionary clause. Central government may appoint. And similarly, Section 4 speaks about the appointment of Chief Wildlife Warden, Wildlife Wardens, and one Honorary Wildlife Warden in each district. And this is being done by the state government. Section 4 also says state government may appoint. So here also that discretionary power is vested with the central government and state government. And state government may also appoint such other officers and employees as may be necessary. And Section 6 says that the state government or the administrator of the Union Territory shall constitute a wildlife advisory board to advise the state government on various aspects covered by this act. So here it is mandatory. Section 6 says the state government or the administrator, whatever the case may be, shall constitute a wildlife advisory board to advise the state government on various aspects. And you can see Section 6 details the composition, who all are there in the advisory board, wildlife advisory board. And it also speaks about the procedure to be followed by the advisory board under section 7. Then the duties of the wildlife advisory board under section 8. Essentially, as the name suggests, it is an advisory board with the primary duty to advise the state government on various aspects covered by this act. So moving on to chapter 3, it speaks about hunting of wild animals, and this provision is also very, very important. We have already seen what you mean by hunting under the definition clause, and let's see what does this chapter says. Section 9 speaks about prohibition of hunting. So what the word used is also important. It is prohibition, not a regulation or restriction. It is prohibition of hunting. And it says that no hunting of any wild animal specified in schedules 1, 2, 3 and 4. So there is no question of hunting of any wild animal which is specified in schedules 1, 2, 3 and 4. And meanwhile, please go through the Bear Act and see what all animals are being mentioned under these four schedules, as well as schedule 5, which talks about vermin. And a few exceptions are also mentioned with regard to this general rule, and those exceptions are given under sections 11 and 12. It says that if the chief wildlife warden, if satisfied that any wild animal specified in schedule 1 is dangerous to human life or is disabled or deceased beyond recovery, he may permit to hunt such animal or cause such animal to be hunted, and he can issue an order in writing and state the reason behind such an order. So it is very, very important to know that the general rule is that there is no hunting which is permitted with regard to any animal which is mentioned under schedules 1, 2, 3 and 4. And in certain exceptional situations, the chief wildlife warden, if that person is satisfied that this particular wild animal specified in schedule 1 has been dangerous to human life or is disabled or deceased beyond recovery and or it is sick beyond recovery, he may permit to hunt such animal, and he should issue an order with regard to that aspect, and that order should also state the reason why he has given such an order. Moving on, the same section also speaks about hunting of any animal included in schedule 2, 3 and 4. So in the previous slide we saw hunting of any wild animal which is specified in schedule 1 alone. So the chief wildlife warden can give permission for to hunt any animal specified in schedule 1 if the following conditions were fulfilled. So here it speaks about hunting of any animal included in schedule 2, 3 and 4. So you should not forget the fact that the general rule is that no hunting of any animal is permitted with regard to animals mentioned under schedules 1, 2, 3 and 4. But here it gives an exception earlier with regard to animals mentioned under schedule 1, and here with regard to animals mentioned under schedule 2, 3 and 4. So what is what are the reasons? So the chief wildlife warden or the authorized officer. So that is, there is also one difference you can see here. With regard to the animals mentioned in schedule 1, only the chief wildlife warden can give permission. But here, chief wildlife warden as well as any other authorized officer, if satisfied that such animal has become dangerous to human life or property. Again, here it is also important to distinguish. In the earlier provision, we saw that it is the only situation where you can give, where the chief wildlife warden can give an order to kill an animal mentioned under schedule 1 was if that animal is dangerous to human life. But here under schedule 2, 3 and 4, if the animal is coming under schedule 2, 3 or 4, if that animal causes any danger to human life or even property including standing crops, or is so disabled or deceased beyond recovery, then the chief wildlife warden or the authorized officer may order in writing stating the reasons, permit any person to hunt such animal or cause such animal to be hunted, and killing or wounding of wild animal in defense of oneself or any other person in good faith is not an offense. So this provision is also very important in the while exercising the self defense. That is also in such case also you can kill or wound wild animals. Yeah. So, killing or wounding of wild animal in defense of oneself or any other person in good faith is not an offense. And one more important point is mentioned here. Any wild animal killed or wounded shall be the property of the government. So, you cannot just take away the wild animal because you killed it. You cannot kill it first of all, but in the exercise of good faith, you can kill a wild animal in defense of yourself or any other person in good faith, which is not an offense. But if at all you kill any wild animal, it shall be the property of the government. So moving on to with the next exemption, which is given under section 12, in which all circumstances hunting is permitted. So we saw section 9 to be the general rule, which says that no one can hunt any animal which is specified in schedule 1, 2, 3 or 4. Then we saw section 11, which says that in certain extraordinary situations with the permission of the chief wildlife warden, you can hunt the animals which are specified in or the chief wildlife warden can allow or give permission to hunt the animals specified in schedule 1. Then we saw in certain other situations where the chief wildlife warden or the authorized person can give permission to hunt certain animals which are mentioned in schedule 2, 3 and 4. And we also saw that in case of exercising your right to self-defense, you can kill the animal, but whatever animal is being killed, it belongs to the, it will be the property of the state. Now, moving on to the next set of exceptions, you can see that the chief wildlife warden may give permission in writing and the reasons to be stated. Permission to be granted to any person on payment of a prescribed fee to hunt for the following purposes. So, if it falls within these specific purposes, the chief wildlife warden may give permission. So what are such conditions? One is education, for education purposes. Say for example, for zoology labs and all, many animals are being required in such labs and all. So education purposes, scientific research, a lot of study is being done, experimentation, animal experimentation is being done. So scientific research, for that also animals are required. Then scientific management. And what do you mean by management? Scientific management is the translocation of any wild animal to an alternative suitable habitat. Population management of the wildlife without killing or poisoning or destroying any wild animals. So all these things are treated or called as scientific management. Then you can also hunt the wild animals with the permission for collection of specimens for zoos, museums, etc. And it is self-explanatory, no need of explaining. And it can also be hunted for derivation, collection or preparation of snake venom for the manufacture of life-saving drugs. So snake venom is used in antidotes and all. So in such case also you can hunt those particular snakes. But all these things can be done only with the permission which is given by the chief wildlife warden. And one proviso is also attached to section 12. It says that no permit can be given to hunt any wild animal under schedule 1 without the permission of central government. So even if the chief wildlife warden is giving permission, that can be done only with the permission of central government, and for any other wild animal without the permission of the state government. So whichever animal is mentioned under schedule 1, even if the wildlife warden is giving you permission, wildlife warden should get the approval or permission from the central government. And with regard to animals mentioned under schedule 2, 3, 4, In such situations, state government should permit the wildlife warden to give such permission. So I hope with this you understood the animals which are listed in Schedule 1 is the most endangered species and the most protected species. So please go through the schedule. The scheme of the act is a little tricky. Like you can see, many amendments has been incorporated into the statute over the period of years. And you can see, if you are researching online, I'm telling you, it's very difficult for you to get an updated statute with all the amendments. You may get the amendments as different files, but after incorporating all the amendments, the whole statute, it is difficult to get online also. Okay, so please make sure that you are getting the final statute which has incorporated all the important amendments also. Okay, so just go through the different schedules which are mentioned under the statute. Now moving on with chapter 3A, you can see it is an amendment which has been inserted in 1991. It speaks about protection of specified plants. We are talking about plants right now, specified plants. And the section 17 capital A to 17 H speaks about the specified plants. And 17 A prohibits picking, uprooting, etc. of the specified plants. As plants which are specified, they are not supposed to be picked or uprooted. And 17B says that permission may be granted by the chief wildlife warden to pick, uproot, etc. of the specified plants for following purposes. So there are certain exceptions, just like what you saw with regard to the provision in relation to hunting. You can see here also. So the permission may be granted. General rule is that you should not pick or uproot the specified plants. But exception says that the chief wildlife warden may give permission in certain situations. And what are the situations? One, education purposes, then scientific research, then for collection, preservation and display in herbarium or any scientific institutions, etc. So where you need these specified plants with special qualities and all for manufacturing of drugs or whatever it is. So in such situations, you need to get the permission from the chief wildlife warden. And section 17CD says that, C and D, both the provisions, it says that cultivation of and dealing in specified plants without license is prohibited. So without license, one cannot cultivate or deal with the specified plants, which is mentioned under Chapter 3A of the Wildlife Protection Act. And Section 17H says that every plant mentioned herein to be the property of state government, just like what we saw with regard to the hunting provision here also, every plant which is mentioned herein, it belongs to the property of the state government. So next is chapter 4, which discusses the sanctuaries, national parks and closed areas. And this chapter we'll discuss in the next class. And these are the important areas which we'll be discussing, like how a sanctuary is being declared, a particular area to be declared a sanctuary, what all restrictions are to be imposed, can be imposed in sanctuary, then what are national parks, what are closed areas. So all these things we'll discuss in the next class. Meanwhile, I would suggest all of you to get the BEAR Act and just go through the BEAR Act because I've not told this with regard to other statutes. When compared to the other statutes in environmental law, Wildlife Protection Act is a bit tricky basically. So there are a lot of amendments which came up in between and various chapters has been introduced in between. So please go through the scheme of the statute and read the main provisions at least. Okay.